stop the music, please? Thank you. So, it is a beautiful first snowy night tonight. Hopefully not too much snow. Not yet. I know. All right. So, hey, my girlfriend lives in Minot, North Dakota, and they are in day three of a massive blizzard. So it could be worse. Could be worse. So after Sunday, I don't know, I was thinking one of the things that I think that we all desire, but sometimes maybe get the wrong idea about is how do we please God? How do we please God? We all, when we love him, we love God. We want to please him. So how? How do we please God? And so, you know, one of the first scriptures I always think about is from Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. But without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. And in the Message Bible, it takes it even a step further, and it starts in verse 5. By an act of faith, Enoch skipped death completely. They looked all over and couldn't find him because God had taken him. We know, on the basis of reliable testimony, that before he was taken, he pleased God. It's impossible to please God apart from faith. And why? Because anyone who wants to approach God must believe both that he exists and that he cares enough to respond to those who seek him. Now, wouldn't we be silly if we prayed and didn't expect a response?
Right.
Wouldn't we be silly to pray and then act like nothing changed? Because when we pray, it's done in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
His promises are yea and amen. So how do we please God? We ask, and we come to him believing that he will do it.
Right.
That pleases God. Mm-hmm. And then when things don't change, we still believe God. And we still believe that it has changed.
Yes.
We believe until with our own eyes we see.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes in this life we do, and sometimes in this life we don't. But we still believe.
Yeah.
Because he is good. And he only gives good and perfect gifts.
Amen.
Psalm 147, verse 11. The Lord taketh pleasure in them that fear him, in those that hope in his mercy. And I love the amplified version of this scripture. The Lord favors those who fear and worship him with awe-inspired reverence and obedience. Those who wait for his mercy and loving kindness.
Mm.
One of the hardest things that we have to do in this world is wait. It pleases God when we wait and we still believe.
Yes.
And the waiting, it's not fun. But it is a fruit of the Spirit to wait. And isn't it funny? Well, probably not. It's not really a coincidence, right? It's linked with worship. So what do? While we wait? If we worship, it makes the waiting pleasing and pleasant to us. It is a pleasure for us. I get such joy out of worshiping the Lord. It makes me feel close to him. It puts things in perspective. It makes him big, me small, and the problems in this world even smaller. And so in the waiting, if we worship, then we're pleasing God doubly. And lastly, in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 21, the King James Version, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
And the Message Bible, I love the Message. It just kind of brings it alive differently sometimes. Bible Gateway, I don't know if anybody's ever used the website. It's called BibleGateway.com.
Yep. Yep.
You can parallel. I think I've got up to six. You can get six translations in one screen. And so you can just look at them all. Because every version brings out a different nuance of the original Greek text or the original Hebrew. And in the Message, it says, pray for us. We have no doubts about what we're doing or why. But it's hard going. And we need your prayers. Isn't that true of all of us in this walk? All we care about is living well before God. Pray that we may soon be together. Again, when we're waiting, when we gather together, it encourages us. It reminds us that we're not in this alone. The enemy would love nothing more than to make us think that we fight these battles and we're in this alone. And that is the biggest lie, because every believer, the of witnesses in heaven cheering us on, the angels sent to minister to us and to do our bidding, and all of those believers that we have relationship with, we are never, ever alone. Not to mention the presence of our God, who never leaves us and never forsakes us. May God, who puts all things together, who makes all things whole, who made a lasting mark through the sacrifice of Jesus, the sacrifice of blood that sealed the eternal covenant, who led Jesus, our great shepherd, up and alive from the dead, now he put you together, provide you with everything you need to please him, make us into what gives him most pleasure by means of the sacrifice of Jesus, the Messiah. All glory to Jesus forever and always. Oh, yes, yes, yes. He does it.
Yeah.
He gives us everything we need to please him.
Amen.
There is nothing, and I know this is kind of what we talked about on Sunday, there's nothing that I can do in my own effort except me. And the Lord says, no, that's the dirty clothes. Let's put the dirty clothes away and come to me, and I will give you my robe of righteousness.
Right.
Jesus, he enrobes us with himself, giving us his righteousness. That pleases God. When we wear that and when we put away the dirty clothes, our own efforts. And he makes us what gives him the most pleasure.
Amen.
He makes us. He sees us perfect. What gives him pleasure is his son, Jesus. That is his ultimate glory, his ultimate pleasure is Jesus. And when we will just lose ourselves and allow Jesus Christ, the Holy Ghost in us, to rise up and have its way, that is the most pleasing thing we can do. And it is a life well pleased where God says, my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased.
Yes.
In Jesus' name. Good news.
Amen.
It is good news. He has done it all. Every time I go back, every time I get tired, I struggle. We have responsibilities. We have jobs. And it gets tiring, but I'm telling you, we just let go of it and let God.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
There is a peace and a joy and a strength. He is our strength in every way. Always encouraged in Jesus'
Amen.
Name.
Amen.
We do have Jody, I don't know who all got her message tonight, but she, Jody has asked for prayer for her mother. Her mother has not been able to keep food down for almost 3 weeks. Jody's mom has lost 40 pounds in the last 3 weeks and is not able to keep any food down. They can't find anything wrong with her in the tests, and they know it's an attack from the enemy. So they've asked that we would join them in prayer for Jody's mother. What's her name? Jody's mother's name? Do we know her name? I can't remember her name. So Jody's mother. That she will be whole, that she will be healed, and this attack of the enemy will stop in the name of Jesus. And the Lord will be her strength.
Yes. Yes.
Anyone else have any prayer requests or testimonies tonight? Yeah, Mike.
Yeah, just keep Cindy lifted up and Myron. Just a lot of stuff going on. Just want to declare the kingdom move forth in their lives, and that the name of the Lord would be glorified no matter what's going on, that people would see the Lord in Cindy's situation, and she gets discouraged because she wants to be here and stuff, and give her a call or message her sometime too if you get, y'all get a chance. And yeah, Myron, he's existing, and that's not the Lord's way. So we just want him restored. How's Robert Red doing? Alan?
Stopped in to see him, and he sends his love. One of his grandchildren, I think, is moving stuff in, and you know, she's having to move, and so
their house is cold.
Somebody thought he had an electrical problem, and I checked into it a little bit.
safe trip, you know, I never take that for granted. I mean, I deal with going up and down the highway, and I know that things can change just in,
oh, yeah.
in a matter of seconds, and I want to pray for, we was going to a school zone, and this mom had this little kid, and she was caring, he was probably two years old. Well, normally I wasn't going to take that route, I was going to go a different way, but I feel, well, I should go this way, and that kid took off and ran out in the traffic, you know.
Oh my.
And his mom just grabbed him, but I always watch through the school zones, and I'm really glad that I was just, I know what to watch for, I've been doing it for a long time, but, you know, somebody else might have come through,
mm-hmm.
and been on their phone or something, because that kid ran out there.
You bet.
You know, and I just was thanking God that just a second here or there could have made a difference. And so I appreciate prayers. And this Sunday, this weekend, we're going down to our grandkid. One of our grandchildren has a birthday, and they asked us to come down. And so we want to be a part of that.
Sure.
Once you get later in the year, sometimes it's hard to travel.
Yeah.
And then I had a prayer request. I had a, sleep apnea, so I have a CPAP machine, but I also do it medication. So the medication hasn't been working so good, so they change it up and have me mix it, rotate with this one medicine and then go back to the old one, and that just is not working. And so they're trying to find out, you know, what combination will work, you know, because I said, you know, I just really need to get a good night's rest.
Amen.
So I said, I deal in a profession that you got to be as sharp as you
can
be every single day. So they're going to contact me tomorrow about, you know, what they can do if they need to up the doses on one or the other. And I ask God to give them wisdom and, you know, allow things to work, because, you know, you have a good night's sleep means a whole lot.
Oh, yeah. Boy. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. So I appreciate prayer for that.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, John.
Yeah, I just want to thank the Lord for being here. I'm usually not able to make it Wednesday nights because of work, but having the 1 year break, so I got a week off. We'll go back on Saturday, geared up for the Christmas rush. You know?
Yeah.
But thank the Lord that have a place like this to come to where there's fellowship in Him. Everything that life throws at us and everything we have to go through and think about and all the negatives or whatever just can all just be falling away when we get in the presence of God and you feel His love and you realize that He is what life is all about. You know, He wants us to be loved regardless of anything and nothing else really matters. Even though the enemy wants to beat us down, you know, we can always know that we're triumphant and more than conquerors, and He doesn't have anything on us. And we can thank God that He gives us the victory, and I'm just so thankful to be with people that are like-minded. It's precious in the sight of the Lord to have unity and love one another, and I just thank God that we can do that even with the ones that aren't here, lift them up. Body being one in Christ. And
yes.
I just thank God that we have victory, you know, even though sometimes it doesn't seem like it or look like it, it's still a reality that God's got the power and we're in Him and complete in Him. And I just thank God that we have a great thing going. I don't know why they call it the good news instead of the great news. It is great. I just thank God that, we win in Him.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Amen.
Michael. I just want to pray for, we had a co-worker here Friday night, had committed suicide at home, and has left a wife and six kids.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, you know, we don't know what he was going through or anything. It was pretty quiet at work, and so we really didn't know, but just want to lift up his wife, it's the Coach family,
mm-hmm.
school kids and stuff, and it's gonna be tough trying to get all their paperwork done and get it submitted, and there's some issues with some of the insurance type items because of how he passed, so I just wanna lift him up.
Yes, yes.
This time.
Amen.
One of my favorite couples is trying to sell our house, so I pray that it gets sold speedily and before Christmas.
Amen.
Amen.
The Lord has perfect timing, and so we have a beautiful home.
Yep.
I'd love for it to be on the east side. Well, and I was gonna say, I told Michael last Sunday when we were driving home from church, I can't remember if I had a dream, if I was in the shower, but I really feel like, and it was after you proclaimed that we were warriors. I told Michael, I said, I don't think this principality and this power on the east side wants us over here because it knows
yeah.
it has to go.
Yeah.
And I think that it is, like, there's a blindness that I think that the enemy is trying to put on people as they come through our home, and I just pray right now in Jesus' name that it's gone.
Yes.
Yeah.
We get
yeah.
good feedback. We're told the pricing's great. We're told it looks great. We're told everything that's good, 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 but no offers. So in Jesus' name, in his time.
Amen.
So we can come, be on the east side, be warriors on the east side.
There you go.
Yeah, it's James.
Well, I'm hoping that I have this in my head. I think it ought to be victory, not violence. If they could proclaim that on TV, that would really help. Really need the census victory.
Yeah.
And I've been saying that in my head for some reason. And you know, this is what we need to work toward. Even as our presidential candidates are in there. We've got to work together. It's going to be different, and we've got to be ready and up and able as warriors, is what you're seeing.
Amen.
So.
Yeah, and we need to continue to pray as they're doing these recounts, too, that nothing fishy happens and the truth prevails. Truth prevails.
And also for those people, where was it, where that plane crashed in Colombia, they didn't know what happened, and all these.
Stand and go to the Lord in prayer. Mm-hmm. Heavenly Father, we come before you tonight. We lift our hands, these families, Lord, these needs to you, Lord. We ask tonight,
Lord,
that you would touch Jody's mother, that you would touch Jody's mother, Lord, that she would heal her body, Lord, and that this, everything would function perfectly, Lord. Give her strength, Lord. Give the doctor's wisdom, Lord. And let it be gone. Symptoms gone. In Jesus' name. Yes, Lord, we pray together right now in Jesus' name. We pray for Tim. Lord, that the sleep apnea gets under control, Lord. Give the doctor's wisdom and touch his body, Lord. Let him get good rest, peaceful sleep, Lord. Yes. Pray for Cindy, Lord. Encourage her. Send ministering spirits to her tonight, Lord. Let her know that she is missed, that she is every much still a member of this body, whether she's here or not, whether she's watching or whether she's here in our presence, Lord. She is a member of this body, of this family.
Amen, Lord God.
Jesus. We pray for the Couch family tonight, Lord. Those children who lost a father, a woman who has lost a husband, Lord. No matter what. We ask for peace and comfort for that family, Lord. Provision for that family,
Lord.
Understanding for those who are hurting, those who mourn. Oh, Jesus, we need you so much, Lord. In every situation, every need tonight, Lord, that you heard. We put our hope and our trust in you. And we know that while we wait, we look to you, we will worship you. We will praise you, Lord, for you are worthy. No matter what happens in this world, Lord. Jesus, you are a good, good Father. You are a good, good Father. Worship. Have your way in this service, Lord. mind and one accord, we gather together to worship and to praise the one true God, the God of Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac, Lord. You are good. You are faithful, Lord. But you never leave us. You never forsake us, Lord. You are our comfort and our strength. You're our protector, Lord. Shine the light before us that we might just walk in it. Let your word be a lamp unto our feet, Lord, as you light up the darkness that surrounds us, Lord. Light up the darkness with your word, Lord, as your word comes alive as never before, Lord. As wisdom and revelation come and take their place in our hearts and our minds, Lord. Let our minds be renewed by the hearing of your word, Lord. And let our hearts be encouraged by gathering together in the name of Jesus. We love you and we praise you. We thank you, Lord, as we celebrate this season, Lord. We celebrate this season where you entered the world and you humbled yourself and became a man. You came as a little baby, born of a virgin, Lord. Humble but powerful. And you showed us how to live and how to walk as a man filled with the Holy Spirit. The miracles, the signs, the wonders you did as the Son of Man before you were resurrected and shown to be the Son of God. That same Holy Spirit is in all of us, Lord. Teach us how to walk and live in that same Spirit, fully the Son of Man, fully the Son of God. That you might say, this is my beloved Son or Daughter, in whom I am well pleased. It is our heart's desire to please you, Lord. As we put our faith and our hope in you and you alone, you are the answer to every problem. You are the solution to every crisis, Lord. We thank you. We thank you, Lord, that it is finished in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Just a reminder that if you brought your cell phone, to turn the ringer off or to just go ahead and turn the phone off. Eastern Gate House of Prayer. Friday, December 9th, 7 p.m. Any words of wisdom for us?
Friday night, focusing on the reason for the season. Praise God. Mm-hmm. He's coming. He's coming.
Yes, he has.
Hallelujah.
All right, let's speak the word tonight. Will you not revive us again? That your people may rejoice in you. I am a believer,
and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover.
Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function, and I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. Yes. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances
you up in my holy name, Jesus, amen.
Lord, Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we bless you tonight. We thank you, Lord, that you revealed yourself to us in the person of Jesus. And as Paul said, let us see only Christ when we look upon each other. Thank you, Lord, for revealing yourself through flesh, through human beings. Your glory, Lord, is revealed through earthen vessels. And we give you the thanks, Lord, for that highest privilege of bearing our Lord and Savior in mortal bodies. Lord, you are the great gift. Every day of our lives is Christmas. You will come alive, Lord, in each of us every day. And we thank you for it and for the privilege of knowing you and being loved by you. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, worship team. Thank you, Suzanne, for opening and sharing with us this evening. Thank all of you for sharing your testimonies and your prayer requests. And it is really, we say it all the time, but it is a privilege to be able to go to the Lord in prayer and take our needs before him. And the good news is he said that when we bring our petitions before him and he hears us, and we know that he hears us, then we have our petition. Praise the Lord. So it's a done deal. Amen. Thank God. Praise the Lord. So we'll get into the word tonight and try to cover everything and be brief at the same time so y'all can get out of here before the blizzard. I don't think we're going to have anything other than just wet stuff, but nobody likes driving in that either. Praise the Lord. You know, I'm a perfectionist. But I'm a perfectionist with a procrastination complex. Someday I'm going to be amazing.
Amen.
I'll let you think about that for a little bit. That's crazy. I'm a lot funnier than me. I understand that. It's okay. Exodus chapter 33 and verses 18 through 23. Exodus 33, verses 18 through 23. Hallelujah, Jesus. What's that? It's in there. And he said, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. This wasn't pre-planned. I mean, we didn't. It was pre-planned, but we didn't plan it. So he said, I will make all thy goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. And he said, thou canst not see my face, for there shall no man see me and live. And the Lord said, behold, there is a place by me, and thou shalt stand upon a rock. And it shall come to pass, while my glory passeth by, that I will put thee in the cleft of the rock, and will cover thee with my hand while I pass by. And I will take away my hand, and thou shalt see my back parts, but my face shall not be seen. All right, let's go to Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1 through 4. I just love it when this stuff happens. You know, it's just it's so like the Lord. Isaiah 6, verses 1 through 4. We're still recovering from that. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried unto another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke.
Come on.
Yes.
1 Kings chapter 19, verses 9 through 13. First Kings 19, verses 9 through 13. And he came thither unto a cave and lodged there, and behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said unto him, What doest thou here, Elijah? And he said, I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, and slain thy prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it. And he said, Go forth and stand upon the mountain before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great strong wind rent the mountains and brake in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind, and after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still small voice. And it was so, when Elijah heard it, that he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood in the entering in of the cave. And behold, there came a voice unto him and said, What doest thou here, Elijah? Last one now, Daniel chapter 2 and verse 47. The king answered unto Daniel and said, Of a truth it is that your God is a God of gods and a Lord of kings and a revealer of secrets, seeing thou couldst reveal this secret. So the mystery in the Bible is defined as the secret thoughts, plans, and dispensations of God that are hidden from human reason. So they have to be revealed to those that it's intended for. In the New Testament, mystery is revealed in a concrete historical event, in the person and the work of Jesus Christ. John chapter 1 verses 14, and then we'll skip down to 18, but John 1:14. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And then verse 18. Okay. No man has seen God at any time, the only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. And then later on, Paul tells us, Christians, that Jesus is the mystery of the entire Bible. Look at Colossians chapter 2, verses 2 and 3. That their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God, and of the Father, and of Christ. And whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. So the mystery of Christ has two sides to it. First, it's completely beyond human wisdom. We couldn't think it up, we couldn't plan it, we couldn't figure it out intellectually. And second, this mystery isn't esoteric or ethereal or otherworldly. It's played out in concrete historical events, mainly in the cross, but also, and as importantly, demonstrated concretely in the church itself, you and I. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 8 through 10. Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ, to the intent that now under the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God.
Yes, known by the church.
So that corrects the assumption that because Christ is the fountainhead or the key part of God's mystery, that there's no more mystery. There's still mystery. Mm-hmm. And it's through us that God is giving revelation.
Yes.
We need to identify with that and understand that as Jesus had a role, ours is identical. We have the same purpose, the same declaration of God to the world. And in order to do that, we have to operate in the same power. Mm-hmm. And that's why he's given us his Spirit, not only that he might dwell in us and be one with us, but that we might be able to declare the glory of God. Look at Colossians chapter 1 and verse 27. To whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. So, in my mind, the exploration of this mystery is real Christianity.
Yes.
That's what real Christianity is. It's not just that we get born again, we pray a prayer, but it's the exploration of this mystery of God in us. And I think, for me personally, I'm just beginning to really comprehend what that means. Now, I'm not saying I haven't known that me and the Lord are one and that God has come to dwell inside me, but I'm talking about how to search the depths of this thing and to live it out in our individual lives the way God intended us to. The church has made it about everything else, made it about our flesh, made it about the dirty laundry, amen, instead of the robes of righteousness, which is what we're talking about here, this mystery, amen. God's mystery always comes as a revelation to humans, and it never comes as the answer to questions. So we ask questions, but really, we don't know what questions to ask.
Mm-hmm.
So God gives us revelation of things we don't even know to ask about, right? I mean, how many of you have had a revelation, had a word of knowledge or wisdom come to you that you weren't asking for? You didn't know to ask for. It just shows up, and it just blindsides you almost.
Yeah.
That's revelation. I'm saying that the human questions never set the agenda in God's revelation. Our questions are not forcing God to give us answers. God has his own agenda, and he answers that agenda. He gives us that revelation to move us forward in him. God always takes the initiative. Amen? So look at Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 20, Mike. Ephesians 3 and verse 20. Doesn't mean that we shouldn't ask questions. It's just that most of the times our questions are so infantile in comparison to the depth and the wisdom and the majesty of God that they are almost idiotic after the fact. Sorry if I offended anybody. Pray the Lord. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask and think, according to the power of the work within us.
Yes.
Amen. God is giving us revelation from us.
Yeah.
Through us.
Yeah.
By him. Yeah. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Amen. So to receive revelation, you have to have intellectual repentance.
Yep.
Think about this. I've had to do a lot of this because we think we have knowledge. We think we know some things that it isn't knowledge God's trying to give us. It's him. It's him alone that he's trying to give us.
Yes.
You look at the Old Testament, all the scriptures we talked about, the mystery. God couldn't reveal himself. He couldn't show himself. And now, here we are with that total revelation given to us.
Mm-hmm.
And yet we don't really delve into the mystery of it. We're content to just have, you know, our name written in the book of life or something, rather than really living out the life of Christ in this earth. Amen?
Amen?
So being satisfied with easy answers and simple formulas limits God. And that's what religion does. I'm not picking on religion. I'm just saying, but that's what religion does. It tries to simplify everything and give you, you know, just answers to whatever your question might be instead of causing us to search deeper and to go deeper into who and what we are in Christ. So we just present a problem-solving God to people. You understand what I'm saying? A problem-solving God. We just present that to people. Like, here's the answer. He's gonna solve all your problems. Now, I'm not saying he doesn't. He does. He's promised to meet all of our needs according to his riches and glory. But when we present God that way, instead of the awesome, mysterious God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God that we've read about just in these four scriptures in the opening here, amen, we end up a God who meets Moses in the thunder, right?
Yep.
And the fire on Mount Sinai, and the smoke, and all of a sudden, if we represent him as just this problem solver, amen, as quickly as we see this majesty and this glory, he could be replaced by a golden calf. A God without mystery. A God you can see. A God that you can just figure it all out just by looking at. And religion has been doing this for thousands of years.
Yes.
And God has always wanted us to delve into the mystery of him so that we might know him.
Yes.
Not about him, not paths to follow, but a God to be one with.
Yes.
Yes.
Look at John chapter 17 verse 3. John 17, verse 3. And I don't want to, you know, confuse you here, but, and this is eternal life, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. That actually translates, the literal translation is, this is God life, that they might know the only true God. Now, we've been given God life, but a lot of us don't even know it. I mean, you know, I'm talking about in general terms. So, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. If you can, Mike, drop down to verse 11, same chapter. And now, I am no more in the world, but these are in the world. And I come to thee, Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are. So the biblical goal isn't to just improve people's lives. It is to improve people's lives. And I can honestly tell you, I've never known anybody, a true Christian, whose life wasn't better after coming to the Lord than it was before. That's a fact. But that is not the biblical goal. That isn't, it isn't what he's really about. It's to know God and to be one with him. That's the goal. And seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, he says, and all these other things get added. We make the things the goal, and God becomes a golden calf. You know, I mean, he becomes something other than this mystery of that God wants to be revealed in us and to us. Amen? So look at Job 26, verse 14. It's the challenge for every one of us. And it's a mystery that is human and God at the same time. Suzanne was talking about this evening. You know, very God and very man. Completely man and yet completely God. We have the fullness of the God in us. We have that same potential.
Hallelujah.
That's not blasphemy. I said Sunday. It sounds like it from, you know, just natural thinking. But that's what Jesus was up against. Didn't he say he was the firstborn of many brethren?
Right.
We are the offspring of God.
Amen.
He calls us that. He tells us we're his children. It's been said several times tonight. This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. He says that of each and every one of us.
Yes.
It's not a gender thing. It's a child. It's an offspring that he's talking about. Amen. So oh, these are parts of his ways. But how little a portion is heard of him. But the thunder of his power. Who can understand? Yeah. Amen. Look at Job 42, verses 3 through 5. Gives me goosebumps when I read those kind of things, you know?
Yep.
Job knew about God, but he had an encounter that changed everything. Yes. Amen. Yeah. Who is he that hideth counsel without knowledge? Therefore have I uttered that I understood not, things too wonderful for me which I knew not. Yeah. Hear, I beseech thee, and I will speak. I will demand of thee, and declare thou unto me. I have heard of thee by the hearing of the ear, but now mine eyes see of thee. Wouldn't we all, that's the testimony that we all want. And in fact, we have it. That's the thing that we have that Job didn't have.
Right.
Is this oneness with God.
Yes.
Our faith has to be in God, not in what we know about God. Mm-hmm. That's what faith is. Faith is not knowledge. Faith is just believing that he is and that he's a rewarder of them who diligently seek him. Amen?
Amen.
Romans chapter 12, verse 2. It puts the adventure back into Christianity. It puts the lifelong pursuit of more of him. Because we'll never get all of it. We'll never be able to breach the vastness of God's totality. Not in this life. But it doesn't change the fact that we should try.
Right.
Amen? Because there's always more revelation. And it comes from within us. He wants the kingdom to be poured out. And it's in us. The kingdom is in you. It's not out here someplace. It's not by observation or something that you can just spot on the street. But it's there. It's in us. Amen? And it gets revealed by us. So he said, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. To me, this is exactly what we're talking about.
Right.
See, the mind, imagination, comes out of the mind. We imagine things. We dream big dreams. We think big thoughts, things that are beyond us, things that we can't just do in the natural, right? Imagination is the first thing. The mind is the first thing to say. Right? The imagination is the first thing to say about us that we limit ourselves.
But
the imagination tells us things that we, you know, it's like I was saying one day I was praying up here a couple, 3 years ago, whenever it was, and the Lord said exactly what you said tonight. Thou art my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased, and I was looking around to see who else was in the church, you know.
Come on.
He's saying things that I couldn't imagine, that I hadn't been able to dream that big of a dream, that I hadn't been able to see myself the way God saw me. Mm-hmm. The mind and the imagination is the first thing to say that we're limiting ourselves, that we're constricting and restricting our potential. Because it like stirs us up for something more. And we think, but is that possible? I mean, can I even expect or dream that reality can be? Well, it's that he's talking about. Renew your mind. Don't be conformed to the natural way of things. Don't be conformed to the religious way of looking at things. Have your mind renewed so that it thinks on the same wavelength with God, like I said Sunday. It's like the tuning fork.
Yes.
If you touch either one of those, it deadens it, you know? But if you hit it and they start to vibrate, you get the perfect tone, the perfect note.
Right.
But only when both of them are vibrating together.
Right.
And that's what's happening with us. We have this sense of reality, call it vibration. I'm picking up some good vibrations, right? Well, it's because whenever we vibrate with God, whenever we're on the same wavelength with God, revelation comes. We're sure that anything can happen, that certainly all things are possible with God, and that nothing is impossible with us if we believe God. Those are the kinds of things we're talking about, renewing the mind. So I'm not saying that we shouldn't understand that there are some things that are set, that are valid, that are real. And I don't mean that there aren't. But what happens when we don't allow our imagination, our mind, to be renewed in this way, it turns out that our home, our thinking, becomes our prison. Mm-hmm. When God intended it to be something that releases us, if our minds are not renewed, our minds become a prison. We become stuck and locked into something that can't be changed. It's only through our imagination or our minds being renewed to the Word of God that we begin to see outside the box. We begin to see outside the earthen vessel and begin to think in ways of the Spirit, in the way that God has created us. Mm-hmm. And as I said, I'm not saying there aren't unchanging truths, but, you know, if you ever, I worked in a hotel in Pennsylvania. It's right in the tri-state area. Hagerstown, Maryland was just down the road. In fact, I lived in Hagerstown for a while too. But just up from Maryland, from the bay. And so the main menu, the hotel was called the Anthony Wayne Hotel, a Revolutionary War general. Old hotel, had been there for years. Very nice place, but very old. And I worked in the bar. I was a bartender on weekends. And during the week, I steamed crabs and shellfish and, you know, shrimp and things like that, mm-hmm. for the restaurant. It was a good job. Got a lot of seafood. Amen. And two rooms in the hotel and all I could drink and all the rest of that stuff. But so I'm saying, well, I learned a few things about crabs. They leave their shell and they get another shell. Right? I mean, they grow another one. That's why you have soft shell crabs, you know, they're the ones that the shell hasn't totally developed. You can actually eat the shell right along with the crab. So it's like a crab. We can move into a new home and still be a crab.
Yeah.
See what I'm saying? And that's what God is saying. We renew your mind. You can shed that old thing and move into the new reality and still be you. Yeah.
Amen.
Absolutely.
And that's what he's talking about, renewing the mind. This treasure in earthen vessels, that's fully man and yet fully God.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19. What, know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and you're not your own? Amen? First Corinthians chapter 12, verse 27. See, it takes all the limits off. Amen. It makes us to understand who we really are in Christ. So there are no limits. All things are possible.
Amen.
Amen. Now we are the body of Christ, and members in particular. Romans chapter 16, verses 25 and 26. We should see the big part we play. We're always minimizing, always diminishing, always limiting. And God has taken all that off and said there is no limit. You can do all things. Everything is possible to him or her that believe. Amen? So now to him that is the power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery which was kept secret since the world began, but now it is made manifest, and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. Mm-hmm. Praise God. See, what he's saying is the human and the divine mystery coalesce. Yes. That's where we're at.
Yes.
Praise God.
Amen.
They become one.
Yes.
The mystery of God continues to be revealed in us. This is the privilege, this is the great honor that we have in God, that he's given to us. Amen? We literally become revelation. Woo! I felt that. Praise the Lord. We become revelation.
Thank you, Lord.
Just as Jesus was a revelation of God. Not to answer all the questions, but to reveal the mystery of God.
Thank you, Lord.
God in humans. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
That's our great prize.
Amen.
For this life.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We don't have to have all the answers because we don't even know what all the questions are.
Right.
Hallelujah. We just need to be the mystery of God.
Amen.
Christ in us, the hope of glory. Amen.
Amen.
Give the Lord a hand. Praise God. Amen. Amen. God bless all of you. Just try to roll these things over and keep these things in your mind, because the enemy wants to rush in and make it, as Suzanne was talking about and we've talked about in the past, he wants to make it about this.
Yeah.
And it is not about this.
Right.
We only say what our Father says.
Amen.
We only do what our Father does. Without him, we can do nothing.
Amen.
But with him,
all
we can do all things.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
God bless all of you. Appreciate you being here tonight. Drive careful going home. I hope to see you back this Sunday. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.